maybe atrial tachycardia, but also can be atypical MNRT or a rare variant of AVRT called permanent junctional reentry tachycardia or PJRT. Then important slide, we just run through it. For narrow QRS tachycardia, you want to see whether regular or not. Ventricle is regular, you just want to confirm whether atrium also is regular or not. If atrium also is regular, it's likely to be atrial fibrillation or multifocal atrial tachycardia. If atrium is regular, whereas ventricle is not, then it's likely to be an organized atrial tachycardia with varying AV conduction. Then you need to know whether P wave is visible or not. The regular QRS tachycardia, if P is not visible, likely you are dealing with an AV NRT. If P is indeed visible, you want to classify whether RP interval is short or long. With short RP tachycardia, you consider 70 millisecond or less, this is 70 millisecond or more. Then you can classify as AV NRT or other short RP tachycardias, which include atypical AV NRT, atrial tachycardia, as well as AVRT. RP is indeed long, commonest cause of atrial tachycardia, others being atypical AV NRT and a PJRT. And if atrial rate is clearly more than ventricular rate, almost always is atrial tachycardia or flutter with varying AV conduction. Once you have a ECG in your hand with narrow QRS tachycardia, cornerstone will be identifying the P wave.
Sir, can you be a bit louder, sir?
More than ventricular rate, there only one
Dr. Mukund?
That is atrial arrhythmia. Okay. Doctor, tell.
Sir, can you be a bit louder, sir?
Yeah, sure. So when you have atrial rate more than ventricular rate, almost always you are going to deal with atrial arrhythmia. Only rare exception is AVNRT with lower common partial block. It's so rare that we not even consider for today's discussion. And even if at all, it is very transient, so it will never cause a clinical diagnostic trouble for you. And if ventricular rate is more than atrial rate, that's a distinct and very uncommon subset with 4 or 5 differential diagnosis, which we'll visit later. But again, you are unlikely to encounter this in your clinical practice. It's a very rare scenario, V more than A narrow QRS tachycardia. And more common scenario which you are likely to encounter is A and V, atrial and ventricular rates being equal. So then you classify them as short RP tachycardia, which we already discussed in the previous slide. If any doubt exists, adenosine can have diagnostic as well as therapeutic indications. So there are so many clues that you can obtain from P waves. So identifying a P wave is extremely important. A regular P wave at a rate of 250 or more suggests an atrial flutter. And perhaps in adults, no other tachycardia can have that much fast atrial rate, though it may sometimes happen in kids. Then P wave morphology, P wave, it can be sinus tachycardia or an atrial tachycardia that is arising very close to the sinus node, that is high right atrial tachycardia. We call it extraterminalis tachycardia because that's the endocardial equivalent of sinus node, which is an epicardial structure. Similarly, inferior P wave axis, sorry, that inferior need to be corrected to superior. Superior P wave axis excludes AV node dependent tachycardias because AV node dependent tachycardias activate the atrium from below upwards. So inferior leads will show a negative P wave. If you are able to clearly identify a positive P wave in inferior leads, can exclude AV node dependent tachycardias like AVNRT as well as AVRT. And lack of an isoelectric segment between consecutive P waves suggests so-called flutter. Current terminology for flutter is a macro reentrant atrial tachycardia, but still more commonly people use the word flutter, so I will stick to it. We'll straight away go to the ECGs now. This ECG of a 1-year-old boy with irregular pulse and a normal echo. As you can see, it's a narrow QRS tachycardia. Heart rate, the shortest RR interval is more than 100, but it's not regular, it's irregular. But next step will be whether atrial activity is regular or not. To take a closer look at lead 2, you can see that there are regular, well-formed P waves happening at the rate of more than 150. However, the AV conduction is varied, that's why you are getting an irregular ventricular rate. So in our flow chart, you can automatically diagnose it as atrial tachycardia because it is A more than V. You don't have any other diagnosis to entertain here apart from sinus tachycardia perhaps. PA morphology is very similar to the sinus tachycardia, but in sinus tachycardia, because it's an autonomically mediated or sympathetically mediated arrhythmia, we expect very good AV conduction, which is not the rule here, and hence it's likely to be an atrial tachycardia arising very close to the SA node, high right atrium or crista terminalis tachycardia. To summarize the findings here, narrow carous tachycardia with atrial rate more than
some issues with that. If you can be more little bit louder today. Today it will be, yeah. You can proceed, sir.
So here is an narrow carous tachycardia with A more than the V. Only two diagnoses: atrial tachycardia or sinus tachycardia. Varying AV conduction. There is an isoelectric period between the P waves. I'm not sure whether you can see the arrow, but this is what I mean by the isoelectric interval. And P wave axis is inferior and similar to sinus node, sinus P wave. So it's a focal atrial tachycardia arising from near the sinus node. So this is the second example, another narrow carous tachycardia. Paroxysmal palpitation in a 64-year-old man. Normal echo otherwise would be tricuspid regurgitation. I marked the P waves for you. When you have regular P waves with no isoelectric interval between them, you tend to call them flutter waves, F waves. And rate of the flutter waves is close to 250, at least more than 200, and A is more than V. So again, A is more than V, it should be atrial arrhythmia. Only exception is an AV and RTA with lower common partial block, which is very rare, so we will not consider that at all. And you don't have an isoelectric P wave with isoelectric segment between the P waves, so automatically your diagnosis is atrial flutter. Now, coming to atrial flutter, there are many types of atrial flutter, but the broadest one will be cava tricuspid, or CTA dependent versus CTA dependent. What's called typical versus atypical. Typical, actually, for the purists, it is counterclockwise CTA flutter, whereas clockwise is called reverse typical. But generally, when you mean atypical flutter, you convey the meaning that it's not CTA dependent. CTA stands for cava tricuspid. How to identify this? In typical flutter, counterclockwise flutter, you will get negative flutter waves in inferior leads and positive flutter waves in lead one. Whereas in clockwise flutter, this relation will be inverse. Positive in inferior leads and negative in V1. It needs an eye to identify negative versus positive because it's almost sawtooth. It can be very confusing. But if you carefully monitor, the slope of this flutter descending limb is different from that of ascending limb. So you name the flutter waves by the descending limb slope, shallower slope. So this is a negative flutter wave. Again, I'm summarizing this for you. Narrow carous tachycardia, A more than V. I'm again nailing the same point. A more than V stands for atrial tachycardia or sinus tachycardia. And varying AV conduction causes an irregular ventricular rate. So if you have an irregular ventricular rate, look for the P, look for the atrial rate, whether it's regular or not. Then if it is regular, see whether it's isoelectric segment or not. If not, you're dealing with flutter. Try to localize it if you want, which is not mandatory. And we'll go to the next AC. This is a 47-year-old man with normal echo. Again, the irregular ventricular rate. So our focus should be on atrial rate, whether it's regular or not. If you see lead 2, you can see fairly regular P waves without any isoelectric segment between them. So this points towards a diagnosis of atrial flutter. And because the flutter waves are positive in inferior leads and negative in V1, you call it clockwise or reverse typical atrial flutter. Nothing much to add over the previous slide except that it's a clockwise flutter. Again, A more than the V, regular P waves, usually rate will be around 250 or 350, between 250 to 350. You will not see any isoelectric segment between the P waves. Of course, there are exceptions to this, but commonly it's like that. And this another lady, 51 years, post BMV, mild mitral residual stenosis, dilated left atrium on a midoron, comes with, you cannot call it tachycardia perhaps because ventricular rate is not that fast. But atrial rate is too high, it's almost 300, at least 275. You can see regular P waves with no much isolatoric segment. Sorry, with some isolatoric segment between them, best appreciated in V1. Rutter waves are positive in inferior leads as well as V1, and this should prompt the diagnosis of atypical flutter. And given the substrate of mitral stenosis, it's highly likely that this is a flutter arising from left atrium. You can see how conduction delay because of amiodarone conduction gets slowed, and that causes isolatoric segment to appear between the flutter waves. So there are exceptions to rules, and this isolatoric segment is one of them, where you still can have an isolatoric segment in flutter, but you pick it by flutter rate of more than 250 usually flutter in adults. So we have a substrate in the history. You know that something is wrong in the left atrium, scarring may happen. So that's the substrate for reentrant left atrial arrhythmias. And this ECG, which suggests a flutter, which is not fitting into the typical flutter description, will prompt you to think about left atrial flutter. So that was an easy one. Narrow cardiostatic edema with A more than the V. You have only limited options, either a focal atrial tachycardia or a reentrant atrial tachycardia, apart from sinus tachycardia indeed. And more common scenario you are likely to get confused as well as likely to encounter is narrow QRS tachycardia with 1-to-1 AV relation. And this should be classified right from the beginning by the P wave RP interval. You tend to classify it as short RP, where P wave falls before half of the RR interval, or long RP, where P wave falls after the half of RR interval. In other words, PR more than RR versus PR less than RR. You know a list of short RP tachycardias. It can be typical AVRT, orthodromic AVRT, and atrial tachycardia with a long PR interval. I should not have written it first. Sorry. It's more commonly typical AVRT or slow fast AVRT and orthodromic AVRT. You know that antidromic AVRT will be not dealing with that today. So it's orthodromic AVRT. And rarely atrial tachycardia with a long PR interval, where PR may be so long that it will tend to fall in the classification of short RP tachycardia. And long RP tachycardias are not as common as short RP tachycardias. You have to consider atrial tachycardia, atypical AVRT, and atypical AVRT called PJRT, permanent junctional reentrant tachycardia. Sudhakar, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
This pop-up is a bit disturbing. Someone is requesting for annotating the shared content. So is it possible to block that for now? Thank you. This is an narrow QRS tachycardia with no definite P wave seen in cursory examination. So it's probably either the P wave is inside the QRS, or you have to examine for the P waves just after or before the QRS. This ECG, you can see the P wave abutting the QRS in V1. I'll mark the blue arrow. Whenever you want to see for the P wave, choose leads which show inconspicuous QRS like AVR. V1, that's a place where you are likely to get a P wave. Other places you may not easily pick up a P wave. So once you identify that there is a P wave, now you can classify it as a short RP because PR is much longer than RP. And within short RP tachycardias, you are interested to know whether RP interval is less than 70 milliseconds or not. Of course, you cannot measure 70 milliseconds in ECG, but the clue is that P will be abutting the QRS in short RP less than 70 milliseconds. Whereas in short RP more than that, it will lie in the ST segment. It will be some gap will be there between the QRS and the P wave. So this is a short RP tachycardia, 1-to-1 AV relation, and short RP less than 70 milliseconds. You have very few differential diagnoses for this, and it's almost always typical AVRT. But very rarely it can be an atrial tachycardia with a PR interval that is so long. This is the PR interval, so long that RP appears to be short, but that's an extremely rare clinical scenario. And for all practical purposes, this is typical AVRT. This one-to-one AV relation, short RP, so short that it appears like a pseudo R dash in V1, and so diagnosis typical AV naught. 29-year-old man with paroxysmal palpitations and normal echo. Again, you have to hunt for the P wave, and your hunt begins at V1. And in this case, it's also very clearly seen in lead 2, 3 and AVF. And even in AVR, you can see the P wave. And in AVR, reveals that there is a small isolated segment between QRS and P. So though it's a short RP, it's not as short as the previous case. And it's definitely more than 70 milliseconds. And now you consider the diagnosis of AVRT, orthodromic AVRT. The approach to narrow QRS tachycardia with one-to-one AV relation is classify it as short RP or long RP. Within short RP, less than 70 milliseconds versus more than 70 milliseconds. And that will lead to either typical AVNRT or an AVRT. Very rarely, it can be atrial tachycardia. Now coming to long RP tachycardias, it's not very common, as I say. 61 years lady cured of lymphoma. That was 6 years back. Now having mild left ventricular dysfunction and dilated left heart chambers. She comes with palpitation with this ECG. Again, it's a pattern recognition, identifying a P within the T wave. Make think that it's a T wave, but at least in some leads, it's so rounded and sharp and symmetrical. So that you should, and here in V3, you can see that distinct notch. This should give you a clue that there is some P wave hidden inside that T wave. It's well evident in V1 and V3. Even in lead 3, the symmetry of the wave should point that it's a P wave and not a T wave. And once you identify that it's a P wave, you measure the RP interval and find that it's long RP interval. So this is a long RP tachycardia. And your commonest diagnosis in this scenario will be atrial tachycardia, with differential diagnosis being atypical AVNRT and PJRT. PJRT is very unusual, more commonly seen in kids, have a very incessant behavior and have a distinct P wave axis. So it's unlike, because P wave axis is always be superior in PJRT, and in this case it is inferior and it's likely to be an atrial tachycardia. This inferior P wave axis by here, axis by itself rules out all AV node dependent tachycardia. So you're not anymore worried about atypical AVNRT, you're not worried about PGRT, upright P wave, long RP interval, P axis, very distinct from sinus PO axis. It's negative in one and AVL, so it's coming from left to right rather than right to left. So it's likely to be left atrial tachycardia, and it was ablated in the mitral atlas. That's all about long RP and short RP tachycardias, but many a time we'll be left with confusion again. Then comes the role of adenosine. So what are things can adenosine do to the heart? It can reduce the rate of sinus node, so sinus tachycardia may slow down. Any automatic tachycardia from the atrium also can respond to adenosine and slow down. It can reduce or block the AV conduction, and that can bring out the P waves in atrial arrhythmias like atrial tachycardia and flutter. So this will alter the AV relation, and ventricular rate will be slowed down because of the AV block, and it will unmask the flutter waves or the P waves. In case of AV node dependent tachycardias, blocking the AV node conduction may terminate the tachycardia. There are some distinct subset of atrial tachycardias called adenosine sensitive atrial tachycardias. Around 20% of atrial tachycardias may respond to adenosine. So such tachycardias may also get terminated with adenosine. Adenosine can shorten the refractory period of atrium as well as the ventricle, but most typically atrium. And this can generate atrial or ventricular ectopics. Maybe just ectopy, or this ectopy can terminate the tachycardia. So whenever tachycardia is terminated by adenosine, you should clearly delineate how it got terminated. Whether it was a clean termination or it terminated in ectopic, like that. And not uncommonly, adenosine can induce atrial fibrillation. What was a regular tachycardia after adenosine becomes atrial fibrillation, leaving with no diagnostic as well as therapeutic use. And how to use the information with adenosine administration. If a tachycardia terminates with a P wave, you understand that adenosine generally acts on the AV node. And if there are fast and slow pathways in the AV node, it will act on the fast pathway. Termination of tachycardia with the P wave suggests a typical AVNRT or an AVRT. Because in AVRT, bypass tract is not sensitive to adenosine. So the last electrical activity will be taken to the atrium through the bypass tract, but it gets blocked in the AV node and so it cannot come down. So the termination is with P wave. Whereas atypical AVNRT, atrial tachycardia and PGRT terminates with QRS. Atrial tachycardia, actually it may not terminate, it will block the AV node, tachycardia will continue, but ventricular rate will slow down. Or if it is sensitive to adenosine, the last conducted tachycardia P may get blocked in the AV node, but usually tachycardia focus is more sensitive than the AV node. So termination is generally with QRS. PGRT, AV node is one of the reentrant limb, anterograde limb, retrograde is through the axillary pathway. So once it blocks, PGRT is slowest limb, slowest conducting axillary pathway, even slower than AV node. So it gets blocked in the pathway itself and you get a termination with QRS. Continuation of tachycardia with the AV block suggests atrial tachycardia or atrial flutter. Some caution during adenosine administration: if there is a pre-excited AF, that will block the AV node but not block the axillary pathway. So ventricular rate may go up and even degeneration to VF may happen. So avoid using adenosine and avoid QRS regular tachycardias. Whenever you have a delta wave and you think that AV node is not part of the circuit, it's all pre-excited tachycardia, never use adenosine. Ensure that a defibrillator and resuscitative measures are available. And bronchospasm is very common with adenosine in asthmatics, so take that history before giving adenosine. And rarely in sick sinus syndrome, sinus may get suppressed and escape may fail to happen. Usually it's transient and sinus or junction will recover. If not, you may have to use atropine. So coming to long RP tachycardia again, probably there's a P wave. It's a 54-year-old lady with moderate mitral stenosis. So you have a substrate for atrial tachycardia. Heart failure symptoms: you suspect that this is a P because the contour is not very typical of a T wave. And in that case, it should be a long RP tachycardia. But any doubt is left, you can give adenosine. So this is what happened when adenosine was given. There's a lead 2 rhythm strip. Adenosine caused AV block. And you can see here tachycardia P waves hitting the mask. They lie outside the QRS, especially the initial strip. Rate is almost around 250. And once the adenosine went away, AV node connection improved. You got 1-to-1 AV node connection and just distance. And finally, the cord got really, you got a sustained attack. Adenosine was terminated with tachycardia. But it induces the AV block and unmasks the AV node. This is a tachycardia. 21-year-old guy with incessant myocardial ischemia. Here we have no clearly available doctor. You can suspect the presence of the CVA in the small dot in the D1, but you can never know which one. But maybe you can add that because the CVA may be inside the regular process. Or if you want to clarify the doctor, you can try to get a discussion. This is what happened when the doctor was given to you. This tachycardia terminated. It can be also a doctor who is a doctor. You can not be sure whether it terminated with a QR or a VP. But it's AV node dependent tachycardia. Don't entertain diagnostic atrial tachycardia here. It's probably. And this is ECG after a while. Same patient ECG. It shows pre-excitation. It's not that pre-excitation was not there in these patients. Whereas it has appeared, same patient ECG after a while. So pre-excitation is intermittent. So this was also from AVRT. And lack of data was since excluded because pre-excitation is intermittent or more commonly conceived state. Conceived state means conduction of the retrograde. So it will not cause the delta variance, the surface is easy. But it can cause post-entry tachycardia. A very, very beautiful example of adenosine. Terminating sinus tachycardia on the foreground is already normal. But it seems there is a long R tachycardia. It's a rhythm of lead 2. Lead 2 is done. So there is a superior diagnosis. This can be a cannot exclude AV node tachycardia. Because the superior, you could have excluded the tachycardia. Whereas low atrial tachycardia will also have a superior diagnosis. It's a long R tachycardia. The definition of that is here should be tachycardia, atypical AVNRT, PGRT, all of them. Now we will be adding all the things and see what happens. specific termination is how we make it appear, and termination is the QRS. When you have termination as QRS, that means the block has happened either in the past pathway or in the PCR here in the dedicated path. The last point is the iteration. Again, if you block continues, so this is an extra piece because you are here with non physiology of the QRS or SI. The hypnosis can tell you as well as when you copy up, you'll see that this is an example of previously used by adenosine also. And the broadcast gained it. Even the sinusitis of preference can see that the rate is slow, it's not fast. And once the AV convection is also, we begin to have a 1.1 convection. And generally, the cardiac fell down because of heart rate. Right? Sympathetic drive is expected to go up, and you can see the automatic sinus expansion. Keeping it with the short. So does the PRR, and the chest is now moving. Sympathetically mediated rebound sinus expansion. At one point, you begin to have a tachycardia onset. You can clearly note that this last sinus wave is followed by the same brain wave which causes tachycardia. And that triggered the re-entry into this long arm tachycardia. This concept is very, very useful because there is no triggering the ectopy. Usually in ADRP as well as AV and RP, premature atrial ectopy is what that triggers the onset of the tachycardia. Whereas here, two of the sinus beat, the first tachycardia involved what you have is happening without any ectopy. The onset in sinus is very much suggestive of CPT-RP. I will not explain that very much here, but just for your free understanding, PGRT has a very slow conducting exercise pathway. This always is excitable gap, long excitable gap, even sinus will trigger the re-entry. Whereas a typical AVNRT or typical AVNRT or AVRT, you need an AT ATL ATL, so that one of the pathways gets called re-entry happens through the other. PGRT re-entry is always the long excitable gap. This is the tachycardia going on. And probably this is the last tachycardia because rate has changed here. Not that, this is definitely the last. It has terminated. Termination, we are not sure. This is the not sure whether it's termination is real or yours. But interestingly, you have a ectopy. This one is an ectopy. It's a different morphology as well as it is a wild type. And probably one divided by repeat, and after that, you get 3 beats of tachycardia, narrow voice. If you multiply by repeat, the results of the tachycardia area. So, this will be something involving the ventilator. So, that means this is likely to be an orthotomy or maybe a return because the PVCs induce the tachycardia area. We have only 3 beats, the truth is very clear. Tachycardia terminates, we have a ventilator, and then it comes to trigger short run of tachycardia. This concept is not caught with PVCs by APCs. APC onset can be AVN and ET as well as LSAT, but once it breaks with PVCs, it can happen at typical AVN and ET. More commonly, it is just AVN and ET. This guy actually had a paradigm set of path 1 by and we saw some AVN and ET. This is a very rare exam, may not see it very often. This is a 62-year-old man. Came in bank registration and this is EEG. Obviously, but he had one tachycardia to begin with. I don't have EEG now. I just wanted to show this. It is no single responsive nature of the ventilator. You see the mean of PP level, the three hypnosis. The PP level, well, the first half of the system. That's what you see. Before I interval by wide, it will focus so strong and finally it terminates. But this is like diagnosing sensitivity to tachycardia. You can see that the AV block is not responsible for termination. It is CP slowing or better relaxation. So the AV condition was also called the CP slowing or better relaxation. This test is 8 those insensitive, people get tachycardia. As I said earlier, it's not uncommon to have a ventricular arrhythmia during the emergency administration. And finally, the normal situation is pedinosis-insensitive tachycardia are not very common. And we don't encounter them easily because we don't do pedinosis for AMP scenarios. And it's hardly rare in the use of the disease. This is And pedinosin should be avoided in case of pre-excited AA or pre-excited tachycardia. Twisting the clues of onset and termination of tachycardia, an abrupt onset or termination suggests a re-entrant mechanism, whereas a gradual onset or termination, it's called warming up in the case of onset, or cooling down in the case of termination, suggests an automatic mechanism. And onset with a sinus beat suggests a permanent junctional re-entrant tachycardia, PGRT. We already discussed that. And spontaneous termination VDP, spontaneous and consistent termination VDP makes the diagnosis of atrial tachycardia unlikely, because for a tachycardia to terminate with a P or spontaneously without a pedinosin, that means that the last tachycardia beat has happened. And that terminates the tachycardia, AV block also should happen the same time for the terminator to VDP. Otherwise, that means we will get a conductor development results. And statistically, it's unlikely that two blocks will happen spontaneously at the same time. So, if you have spontaneous termination with PU, you can almost always exclude an atrial tachycardia. These rules apply only to 1-to-1 AV conduction. When you have 2-to-1 tachycardia, this rule should not apply, because even otherwise you have AV block. So, termination with P can still happen. But if you have 1-to-1 AV collision, then tachycardia terminates with P spontaneously, you can exclude automatic atrial tachycardia. You get a LED ECG that documents onset or termination of tachycardia. But if you are fortunate, you more commonly see it in the halters. But if you are fortunate enough to see this, always analyze the mode of onset. As you can see here, it's an arrhythmia of tachycardia, regular, probably 1-to-1 AV relation. You don't know the PO axis because you don't have tachycardia in interior leads. Nonetheless, there's a regular PP interval up to here. Suddenly, this P wave is changed in morphology. And this is the atrial ectopy that triggers the tachycardia. Triggering with atrial ectopy generally happens in either atrial tachycardia, either AVNRT or AVRT, and AVRT also includes CGRT. So this is the long RP tachycardia, which is not very common in typical AVNRT as well as AVRT. So you have to consider atypical AVNRT or a CGRT in this scenario. So simple onset tracing helps you to zoom in on two differential diagnoses, atypical AVNRT and CGRT. This is an example for tachycardia termination. You can see that tachycardia is 1-to-1, very rapid 1-to-1 to begin with, very high atrial rate is seen. And by the end of, by the mid part of the rhythm strip, the atrial rate has slowed down and so has ventricular rate. And finally, it terminates and sinus returns. So this probably is atrial tachycardia, or the automatic mechanism. This is called cooling down. And I have this tracing. You can prefer beta blockers because it's automatically mediated tachycardia. It's likely to respond to beta blockers. A 14-year-old boy, recurrent palpitations, almost daily episodes, mitral dysfunction. And This is a very typical substrate or clinical scenario for PVRT. Young age, sensors and tachycardia. Any ECG you take will have some with tachycardia, onset with termination, break and break. This keeps on happening. And tachycardia myoplasia setting was causing normal LV function to worsen over time, like mild LV dysfunction. This is a PVRT, as I discussed earlier. The onset during sinus beat. I'm sorry, I'm not showing the onset here. This is the PVRT. Remember this ECG. It's a very important pattern. Long RV tachycardia. Superior PVR axis. Tachycardia terminates. Gets reinitiated. The termination is with QRS. Initiation is in sinus beat. Initiation is sinus beat. Incessant nature. Long RV. Superior PVR axis. Young age. Probably LV dysfunction. Either normal or mild. All suggest PJRT. Permanent junction reentrant tachycardia. The form of AVRT again with the atypical pathway that is slow to conduct and conducts only retrograde, so you won't get a re-excitation. We have 15 more minutes left. I will just accelerate. This is a narrow QRS tachycardia with V more than A. We'll just briefly visit very common clinical scenario, but we have five differential diagnoses. Some people say six, stretching a theoretical possibility. So junctional ectopic tachycardia or JET, this is the most common thing that you are likely to encounter when you have a narrow QRS tachycardia with V more than A. JET itself is rare, but nonetheless, it's the commonest thing you are likely to encounter. AVNRT with upper common pathway block. Just don't worry about this upper and lower common pathways. It just means that from AVNRT circuit to the atrium, that way it is blocked. Whereas AVNRT circuit to the ventricle, it still conducts. Whereas lower common pathway block means AVNRT circuit to ventricle, that route is blocked. But AVNRT circuit to atrium, that route is still conducting. So AVNRT with upper common pathway block will cause V more than A because you are blocking the route from tachycardia circuit to the atrium. Upper septal VT. VT arising from very near to the conduction system, high in the septum. It will be narrow. Even the QRS axis can appear narrow and normal, similar to the sinus QRS. This can have V more than A. Nodo-fascicular as well as nodo-ventricular reentrant tachycardias. Nodo-fascicular and nodo-ventricular, if they are orthodromic, conduction will happen down the His-Purkinje system, up through the axillary pathway, up to the node. Circuit ends there. Atrium is not part of the circuit, so you can have ventricular rate higher than the atrial rate. In the rare situation of double fire, which is very interesting, we have dual AV node physiology, one fast pathway and one slow pathway. Every P goes down the fast pathway, but retrogradely it cannot penetrate the slow pathway. Retrograde cannot penetrate slow pathway. So once it causes a QRS, again you get another QRS mediated through the slow pathway. Same P wave goes down the fast pathway, down the slow pathway, and consequently causes two QRS complex. So there will be one A followed by two QRS. And you have two PR intervals, both will be constant. PR1 will be same, PR2 will be the same. They both will be different, but will be constant. It's also very extremely rare clinical scenario, but you can have narrow QRS. It's called non-reentrant AV nodal tachycardia. It's not re-entry, it's double fire. So for all practical purposes, if you have a narrow QRS tachycardia with V more than A, you are likely to be dealing with junctional ectopic tachycardia. All others are rare, but nonetheless very interesting to know of. So this is a 2-month baby, failure to thrive in heart failure. You can clearly see that there's a narrow QRS tachycardia going on, and if you see the rhythm strip, you can see V is totally dissociated from A. This is a P wave here, another P wave with non-physiological PR interval. This P cannot be linked to the QRS. It's so short, it's non-physiological. Whereas this P lies in between the two QRS. So PR interval or RP interval, whatever we want to call it, is extremely varying, and atrial rate is slower than the ventricular rate. So this is a case of junctional ectopic tachycardia. There are three types of JETs based on when you encounter it. One is infantile form, very difficult to treat and very lethal also. It's called congenital JET or infantile JET. Second, more likely scenario is post-operative setting in congenital heart disease. But usually you will have a right bundle branch block and wide QRS in that setting. And isolated form that occur in adults. All of them are, except the post-operative form, are extremely rare. And generally, I've never seen a narrow QRS post-operative JET because almost always they will have right bundle branch block related to the congenital heart disease. But nonetheless, it's important to correctly classify this tachycardia, narrow QRS tachycardia with V more than A. There are only 5 or 6 differential diagnoses. And it's easy to remember also. So never miss this substrate. This another example of a 65-year-old gentleman with inferior MI and normal ejection fraction. He came with this ECG. Apparently, it's a narrow carous tachycardia. It's still less than 120 milliseconds. It's a relatively wide narrow carous tachycardia, but nonetheless, it's narrow because it's 120 milliseconds. And if you see the rhythm strip, you can clearly see that P waves are there and are dissociated from QRS complexes. This is a P wave here. Another one is before the QRS here. While here, this is almost partly inside the QRS. This means that there is no PR interval here, and atrial rate is definitely less than the ventricular rate, and ANV are dissociated. So it's one of those five differential diagnoses. And you can interestingly see that V1 to V6, QRS is entirely positive. It's called positive precordial concordance. You have never seen a sinus rhythm with V1 positive as well as V6 positive in normal hearts. This positive precordial concordance suggests that it's a ventricular tachycardia. This is an example of scar-related upper septal tachycardia. Upper septal tachycardia are usually idiopathic, but can also happen because of scars. So this is a ventricular tachycardia, which is narrow, but V more than A, and can be classified as a narrow QRS tachycardia. Two important messages here. Positive concordance is a sign probably of VT. Only very few exceptions of SVT can have this positive precordial concordance. This is the basal ECG of the same patient. You can see that V1 is still negative. It became positive during tachycardia, but in sinus rhythm, it is negative. You can see fragmentation of a QRS suggesting a scar in the inferior leads. And even lead 3 and AVF is showing Q wave. And mind you, VT can be narrow if it arises from the conduction system, like vesicular or intravesicular VT. If it engages conduction system early in the course, like in this case, or in digitalis toxicity, where all intervals except PR intervals tend to get shortened. Okay, 43-year-old man. This ECG you may not see again, it's so rare. Yes, AF ablation 2 years ago, and now continues to have palpitation. On a cursory look, this is again a narrow carous tachycardia. Probably, at least some people may call it irregular, but there is a regular pattern here. It's a bijameral pattern. You can see that though there is RR variation, you have group beating, 2 QRS followed by a pause. Again, 2 QRS followed by a pause. And this RR interval is constant, RR dash as well as R dash R interval. Both are different, but within them they are constant. Now try to delineate the relation between A and V. You can see that this P wave is related to this QRS with PR1, 160 milliseconds maybe, and also related to this QRS with another PR interval, this much, which is constant. The same pattern is repeating itself. PR1 is constant, PR2 is constant. PR1 and PR2 are different, but there is a AV relation, and A is more than V, and this is an example of double fire. This P went through the fast pathway and caused this QRS. Again, went down to the slow pathway and is responsible for this QRS. So it's a non-reentrant junctional tachycardia. It's very rare. You need not learn this or know this, but it's very interesting to know. It's an example of narrow QRS tachycardia with V more than A. This is the final segment of the talk. Changes in cycle length. They are not very common in surface ECG, but you may happen to see them in Holter as well as the EP lab. If you have an oscillation in cycle length, that can be used for making a differential diagnosis between the SVTs. How to use them? You have the AA interval or the atrial rate as well as the RR interval or VV interval, the ventricular rate. If atrial rate precedes and predicts that of the ventricular rate, that is A is driving the V, it should be atrial tachycardia or atypical AVNRT. Just remember A for A. Changes in AA interval. AA in surface ECG is PP interval. PP interval precedes and predicts that in RR interval. You are dealing with atrial tachycardia or an atypical AVNRT. Whereas changes in the ventricular rate, RR interval, precedes and predicts those in PP interval, you are likely to deal with typical AVNRT or AVRT. We'll show how the logic behind that. Changes in RP or PR with a constant PP, that is PP is constant, it's not affected by changes in the PR interval. That means PP is the responsible focus, atrial tachycardia. Whatever changes happening in AV node is not affecting the tachycardia, means it's not AV node dependent tachycardia, it's atrial tachycardia. Whereas changes in RR interval with constant RP interval suggests it's an orthonormic AVRT. Both of these are very rare, so we'll not discuss this further, but these ones I will explain with the diagram. Whenever there is a cycle length change, either it can happen at the level of focus, like atrial tachycardia, it's a sympathetic or triggered activity, changes in autonomic tone causes changes in the cycle length. So this change reflects in the atrial rate, because atrium is driving the ventricle in atrial tachycardia, these changes are getting reflected in the V as well. So if you have atrial cycle length change driving that of the ventricle, is likely to be atrial tachycardia. It can also happen in atypical AVNRT. The logic is, when you have a slow pathway and fast pathway and cycle length changes, usually the slowest conducting limb is responsible for the cycle length change. In this case, it is AVNO-dependent AVNRT, it is slow pathway. And in atypical AVNRT, activation happens down the fast pathway and up the slow pathway. So if you have a cycle length change happening in slow pathway, it will first get reflected in the atrium, because atrium is immediately uphill to the slow pathway. Once it is slow pathway activation, you are not able to see in the surface ECG. So what you will actually see is change in the atrial cycle length, because it's immediately uphill to the slow pathway. And this AA interval subsequently causes change in the VV interval. Fast pathway is not responsible for cycle length change, it's always a slow pathway. So anything happen here, this direction arrow is for typical AVNRT, and we are talking about atypical AVNRT. So don't get confused here. So slow pathway is responsible for cycling change. It first gets reflected in the atrium and then in the ventricle. So AA driving the VV suggests atrial tachycardia or atypical AVNRT. Same logic, if it's a typical AVNRT, up by the fast pathway and down the slow pathway. So anything happening in the slow pathway first get reflected in the ventricle, then only comes to the atrium. So VV driving AA suggests either typical AVNRT, or in the case of axillary pathway always is responsible for all or none conduction. It will not cause slow conduction. So slowness is always happening in the AV node. Between fast pathway and axillary pathway is more stable to conduct. So any cycling change that happens is likely to happen in the AV node and first get reflected in the VV interval, ventricular rate. So A driving the V, AA changes driving the VV changes is A for A, atypical AVNRT or atrial tachycardia. Whereas VV driving the AA, VV changes dictating AA changes is typical AVNRT or orthodromic AVNRT. This yellow color just hints that whichever place that is responsible for the cycle length change. This is an example for AA driving the V. This is an irregular narrow QRS tachycardia. I have this patient's halter more magnified. You can see that cycle length changes happen first in the A, then in the V. This was an atypical AVNRT because it terminated spontaneously with P as well. This is the P wave. Last P wave didn't get conducted to the ventricle. That excludes the AT tachycardia. So we have to start with only two differential diagnoses, atypical AVNRT or AT. It's a long RP tachycardia. I'm sorry, it's not zoomed enough for you to appreciate the change. But in V1, you can clearly see that PP interval shortens first, then RR interval shortens. This is the PP here. Next PP is shorter. So P is driving the QRS, A is driving the V. So automatically our differential diagnosis is atrial tachycardia, but Holter shows that it gets terminated with a P wave. That excludes an atrial tachycardia and we are left with atypical AVNRT. Effects of bundle branch block. This also is not very common in clinical practice. You are more likely to encounter it in either in Holter or in the EP lab. Bundle branch block should not affect cycle length changes in AVNRT as well as atrial tachycardia, because ventricle is not part of the circuit. However, in atrioventricular reentry, AVRT, ventricle is the part of the circuit, and if the bundle branch block happens to be the same side of the pathway, for example, left lateral pathway, you get a left bundle branch block, or right lateral pathway, you get a right ipsilateral chamber, then your tachycardia wave front has to take a longer course. For example, if left bundle is blocked, just go down to the right bundle, cross the septum, enter the LV, then reach the pathway. That means a longer path length. That slows down the tachycardia. So if you have a tachycardia going on, narrow QRS tachycardia, suddenly it widens. You get LVV morphology. Now you check the cycle length. Apart from the widening, there is also a slowing of tachycardia, means you are dealing with left-sided axillary pathway. Or if it's RBB with slowing tachycardia, it's a right-sided pathway. But whatever it is, more important message is bundle branch aberrancy affecting the cycle length happens only in AVRT, not in AVNRT, not in atrial tachycardia. If you have narrow QRS tachycardia, which suddenly widens as well as slows down. the axillary pathway mediated tachycardia. Apart from this, left mitral band separancy is 90% AVRT, not in AT. Mere presence of left mitral band block efferency itself points towards AVRT. Statistically, what I just now said, the axillary pathway here is a left bundle. Suddenly, left bundle is getting blocked. So now it has to course down to the right bundle, through the intra septum, into the left ventricle, then reach the pathway. That causes longer path length, and hence tachycardia cycle slows down. From 300 milliseconds, it has become 360 milliseconds. It takes an additional 60 milliseconds to take this circuitous route. Simple message is, navigation slows down the tachycardia means it's an AVRT. It's not AT, it's not AVNRT. Finally, the most controversial thing, QRS alternates. Conventional school of thought was that QRS alternates suggests that AVRT. But current school of thought is that it can happen in any fast SVT. However, if it happens at slow rates like 100 or 120, then it may perhaps indicate AVRT. But I would suggest never go by QRS alternates. We are yet to do the EP study of this girl who came yesterday. The 13-year-old girl is an example of QRS alternates. You can see very marked variation in QRS morphology here in B2. Every alternate beat is having a different morphology. So, QRS alternates, and it's happening at a heart rate of nearly 250 or 260. Two things to learn from this. One, very rapid tachycardias in the range of flutter is not very uncommon in kids. They can have really fast heart rates. And QRS alternates doesn't mean that it's AVRT. It can still be AVNRT. We have not done EP study, so I'm not sure specifically what this was. And most important, I'm presenting it last, looking for the P wave. P wave may be easily evident or maybe not. We have seen examples for both scenarios. If it's easily evident, then well and good. If not, we have to make every effort to identify a P wave. We have to compare with the baseline ECG if available. A slight notching or alteration in the ST or QRS may point that there's a hidden P wave there. Still doubt remains, we give carotid sinus massage or adenosine, or we can use this Lewis lead. Lewis lead is nothing but lead one. You are changing lead one into manubrium sternum or right second space, and negative pole will be fourth intercostal space just right to the sternum. Now, whatever lead one you are recording is the Lewis lead. It was classically described to bring out flutter waves. This is a very interesting. I don't call it tachycardia here because heart rate is just below 100. On a cursory look, you may think that's a sinus rhythm, but if you see closely, V1, you can see hidden P waves just after QRS. For every QRS, there are two P. So it's a 2-to-1 atrial tachycardia going on. So message is, P waves may be hidden, not be evident in every lead. So look at every lead, especially V1 and AVR, close to the QRS, inside the ST, or notching of the T, or maybe this is a notching of the T here, or maybe pointing that there is a hidden P wave there. This is another tachycardia. Some people will say there is a P, some will say there is not. But again, some clues are there. There's a notched T wave here, probably the wavy baseline here. V3 is showing a hint of notching, so there may be a P wave. So, what to do? Adenosine, carotid sinus massage, or take a Lewis lead. Need some effort, but this is a Lewis lead. Just compare the T wave there in the Lewis lead, lead one. It's almost not there. T wave is not seen in lead one, but in the Lewis lead, apparently something has come up, and probably that's a P wave. Still doubt remains, just give a carotid sinus massage. Brilliant P waves are seen, and A is more than V, so it's an atrial tachycardia. This is an example of AVNRT with lower common pathway block. I think I will omit this, it's already 7. It's not very common. It's only seen perhaps in Holter. Hardly will you see this in 12 lead ECG. To summarize, identifying P wave is very crucial in supraventricular tachycardia. Once you identify it, delineate AV relation 1-to-1 or non-1-to-1, A more than the V versus V more than the A. And if 1-to-1, short RP versus long RP, then you have only 3 or 4 common differential diagnosis, and it's very easy. You will be right almost always, all the time, if you go systematically. And these two quotes are pertaining to P waves. I leave it for you to read. I'll conclude here.
Sir,
have time sir. To take questions, Sudhakar, or should we stop?
No, sir. Actually, yeah, I think there was some very crucial technical issue. We were not able to unbeep the participants coming in.